stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He, and together we sing.
Keep singing, holy is. Good morning. Happy Easter. He is risen. Hey, let's stand together. We're going to open up with a traditional song. The Lord.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. Sons of men and angels sing. Hallelujah. Raise your joys and triumphs high. Oh, hallelujah. Sing ye heaven and earth. Again, our glorious King.
Hallelujah.
Where, O death, is now thy sting?
Redeeming.
Us redeeming. of men, sons of men, and angels say, Hallelujah.
Raise your joys, raise your joys, and triumph high.
Hallelujah.
Sing ye heaven and earth reply.
Kind of way.
it was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried. At the weight of your glory, I needed shelter. I was an orphan, but you called me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. But your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. Just when you call my name.
God is good, isn't he? Please, before you take a seat, turn to the person next to you and let them know how glad you are to see him here this morning.
Well, good morning, everybody. Happy Easter. Welcome to Cedar Run Community Church. We are so glad to have you with us here this morning, and a special welcome to all of our visiting friends and family and co-workers and people that are hanging out with us today. Give them a hand, yeah. Somebody saw me today. They're making fun of the fact that I'm wearing a sport coat. You know it's a high holy day if Pastor Blake is wearing anything but an untucked flannel shirt. Just a couple of quick announcements as we get rolling. And this is also to the visiting friends and family and co-workers. We're having a very special day this very next Saturday. It is our spring carnival. So visitors, come to the carnival, okay? But we're going to have a live animals petting zoo. It's going to be amazing. It starts at 10 right here at the church. And we tried to get a lion and a lamb. We had insurance problems, though, with the lion. So we're settling for a donkey and a llama, all right? But that will work, okay? So we're looking forward to seeing you guys here on Saturday. And the last thing I want to mention is after church on Sunday, we are having a luncheon, a parent luncheon for our student ministry. Student ministry parents, come see what's happening in student ministry. Josh will be kind of giving us his vision. We'll have lunch. So free lunch, can't miss that. And we will have childcare. So we hope to see you at the luncheon next Sunday. And with that, back to worship.
So sorry, man. I'm throwing you out there. I keep going back to the same one. Give me one first. You do it.
Let's stand. Sing about who this day is all about. Precious blood of Christ.
stand. Amen.
This is a song that maybe many of you know. Did do a little bit of different twist to it. So instead of 3/4, it's 4/4. But everything should still fit together, I think, here. So we thank you, Lord. We thank you for all that. Lord, we just thank you for your Holy Spirit, for dwelling in this place. I just can't imagine taking on the sins of the world and walking up Calvary with a cross strapped to your back, beaten to near death. What a God. What a story, Lord. On an old faraway stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, the dearest and best, for the world of lost sinners now a slave. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross, my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. The old rugged cross, despised by the world, has wondrous attraction to me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above, a baritone dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay. For was that old cross Jesus suffered and died? For was and in the earth of me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophy.
Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory never lost land. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross
Technically, that's not my generation that does that, but please be seated.
Part of our Run Kids ministry, that is from the nursery all the way up to and including fifth grade, you can go out the back. Our Run Kids children ministry, folks, is one of our strongest ministries here at Cedar Run. And if you're a parent visiting here today and you want to go back and check out what happens with the kids, Nadita and Heather and Emily be glad to see you guys, so you can head out with your kids if you like. It's also Cedar Run's version of the NFL Combine 40-yard dash.
I'll be reading from Mark 16, 1 through 6. When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. And he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him." This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. Thank you, Josh. Thank you, worship team. Man, it was rocking on up here. I thought I had visions of the temple being torn and true, and you know, music stands flying here and there. It was pretty awesome. Well, he is risen. Or as the angel put it in the passage from the Gospel of Mark that Josh just read for us, he is risen. He is not here. Today we celebrate the wonderful truth that Jesus Christ, whose dead body had been taken down from the cross upon which he had been executed just 3 days before, was no longer dead. Because he had overcome death and the grave, just as he promised that he would. Mark 8:31, he had said this previously. And he began to teach them, this is Jesus, that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed. And after 3 days, he would rise again. And I will talk more on the actual resurrection in the second part of my message this morning. But first, I want to go back to the cross. Because as you've heard me say before, there would be no Easter if not for the cross. There would have been no death to overcome if Jesus had not allowed himself first to be killed. Let me lead into that by sharing with you two stories. Both of these are true. The first is a story of the U.S. satellite Mariner 1, which in July of 1962 took off from Cape Canaveral in Florida on a mission to conduct the first American exploration of the planet Venus. But shortly after liftoff, the satellite began to veer wildly off course, and it had to be destroyed in flight. What was the cause of the problem? Well, it turned out that a single tiny hyphen had been omitted from the programming data in the computer. That was the culprit. And that missing hyphen cost the American taxpayer over $18 million. Second story is of a woman who, while touring Europe, called her husband back here in the States, cabled him the following message by telegram. "Have found a beautiful diamond bracelet. The price is $75,000. May I buy it?" The husband, who choked on the cost, immediately responded back with the following telegram. "No, exclamation point. Price too high, period. Well, a week or so later, when she returned from her trip, her husband was at the docks to greet her. And to his dismay and shock, she was wearing that diamond necklace. Well, before she could tell him how wonderful he was to let her spend that incredible amount of money for the necklace, he blurted out, "Didn't you get my telegram?" To which she responded, "Yes, she had." And handing it to him, there it was in black and white. No price too high. Yeah, you guys are pretty sharp. You get it. The telegraph operator had omitted one simple exclamation point, and its absence ended up costing this husband a whole lot of money. True story, he actually sued the telegraph company and won. After which the telegraph rules were changed to require operators to spell out punctuation marks rather than to simply use the symbols. But so what is my point here? Two symbols, one a hyphen, one an exclamation point, were omitted in these instances at great cost. Well, I want to remind us this morning that there's a symbol that we humans can ignore that can end up costing us much more than just money. It is a symbol that is, if not addressed in our earthly lives, will end up robbing us of the meaning and joy and peace that we all are searching for in this life. That if we never come face to face with, will cause us to wander through our time on this planet with no direction, and will end up destroying the eternal destiny that God wants for all of us. This symbol I'm referring to is not an exclamation point or a hyphen. It is a plus sign with the vertical member lengthened to form a cross. You see, if we never come face to face with the cross and the man hanging on it, if we never come face to face with the implications of who he was and why he was being executed there, then just as the Mariner 1 spacecraft was veering wildly off course, wandering aimlessly through the solar system, and ultimately had to be destroyed, you will wander aimlessly through your life and will one day face ultimate destruction as the price you will pay for ignoring the gift that God was offering you when Jesus hung there on that cross. And don't make the mistake here. I'm not just talking about the cross's effect on your spiritual life here, okay? Or as some might think of it, its effect on your church life, right? I wonder if you, like many, try to compartmentalize your life or your church life from the rest of your life. Well, you know, there's the stuff the pastors or my youth leader talks about that I need to be aware of so I can apply those when I'm at church. But those principles, those truths, don't really have all that much applicability to the rest of my life. My time in school, or on a local sports team, or at work, or at a neighborhood event. No, friends, I believe every area of your life will either come together or will fall apart based on how you address the cross and what Jesus did there 2,000 years ago. And lest you think that Pastor Dave is a little confused and thought I was supposed to be giving the Good Friday message here, okay? I do know today is Easter, all right? This is Resurrection Day, the day Jesus overcame the death that he experienced on the cross. And that is why I have titled this message as The Cross and the Empty Tomb, because those two events are inextricably linked in God's plan for you and for me. Yes, there would be no Easter without the cross if Jesus had not actually died then he could not have risen from the dead, obviously, right? And we would have nothing to celebrate today. But if he had not risen from the dead, if the cross was the end of the story, then his would be just another obituary describing someone's passing that has long been forgotten in the dustbin of history. So it is both the cross and the empty tomb that we celebrate. And in the balance of my message this morning, I want to address two practical outcomes in our lives that I believe we have the opportunity to experience because of those two events. All right? First one, gives us purpose for living. Our lives on this earth really have no ultimate purpose or meaning without the cross and the empty tomb, do they? Because it's only through those two events that you and I can come into a relationship with the God who created us. I shared this before, but it is the only way, as Blaise Pascal, remember, he was the man who was the original formulator of the mathematical equations that led to the computer, and he said this, "There is in every single human being a whole, and we live all of our lives, trying to fill that hole. We try to fill it with money, with success, with pleasure, but none of them work. Why? Because it is a God-shaped hole meant to be filled by the God who created you in his image. Yes, we can get into that routine of we get up, go to work or school, go home, and then we just do it all again the next day. And we know something is missing, but we never stop long enough to contemplate what that might be." I think one of the best characterizations of this dilemma was captured by Billy Crystal in the movie City Slickers. Crystal is struggling with finding some meaning in his life. And he's addressing his elementary school class, okay? It is bring your dad to work day. And he provides the following description, I believe, of someone whose life has no purpose. See if anyone here can relate to this, particularly some of you that are older like me. It goes like this. "Value this time in your life, kids, because it goes by so quickly. When you're a teenager, you think you can do anything, and you do. Your 20s are a blur. 30s, you raise your family, make a little money, and say to yourself, what happened to my 20s? 40s, you grow a pot belly. The music starts to get too loud, and one of your girlfriends from high school becomes a grandmother. 50s, you have minor surgery. You will call it a procedure, but it's a surgery. 60s, you will have a major surgery. The music is still too loud, but that doesn't matter because you can't hear it anyway. 70s, you and your wife retire to Florida. You start eating dinner at 2 in the afternoon. You have lunch around 10, breakfast the night before, and you spend most of your time wandering around malls looking for the ultimate soft yogurt and muttering, how come the kids don't call? How come the kids don't call? You know, I fear that that is a tragically accurate description of the lives of many whose major goal in life is simply to work long enough so that they can retire comfortably. And then when they get to that place, they spend most of their time grumbling about life passing them by. Is that all there is to life? Or is there something more? Friends, we were made by a purposeful God who has a purpose for your life. And deep down, I think we all know that, no matter what the culture we live in tries to tell us. You know, this is one of the concerns I as a pastor have about what is being taught in many schools today about creation. you know, the teaching that the universe was not created by a purposeful God, but came about by random chance. Yet if we spend just a moment studying the incredible order and design of this universe, it defies logic to conclude that it was created by some sort of random explosion out of nothing. I think it was put best by William Paley. He was a 19th century theologian, clergyman, who said, if you were walking through a field and you came upon a rock, it's perfectly possible that rock just happened to be there. But if you come across a beautiful watch, you know there had to be a watchmaker. And then what about us human beings, huh? Does it seem rational that the incredible, intricate human body came about by some accident that occurred billions of years ago in some primordial soup that existed here on this planet? That's a far bigger leap of faith to me than believing I was created by a purposeful God. And if it was all just an accident, and there was no creator who created it all, well then, friends, I can understand why someone might say there is no meaning or purpose to life. Because if that's true, you and I were born into this world to live a paltry few years and then turn back into the dust from whence we came. I mean, there's no greater reason for your or my existence. Ah, but because of the cross and the empty tomb, that tells a very different story. The Apostle Peter put it this way, 1 Peter 1, verses 18 and 19. Knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways, empty ways, it says in another translation, inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ. Peter, in referring to that futile way or empty way of life, is describing essentially life without Christ, as a life without meaning. And that's the way life tends to become when you don't have that personal relationship with the God who created you. There's a line in a song that came out when I was in high school. The song was titled Reflections of My Life, and it had this haunting line. The world is a bad place, a terrible place to live. Oh, but I don't want to die. That's the world you live in without Christ. Yes, this world can seem like a bad place because of our sin. But God wants to use you, and He wants to use me to be a healing source in the midst of it all. This is what Jesus meant when in the Sermon on the Mount, right out of the gate, He says, you are to be the salt of the earth. Salt was a healing preservative. Jesus came to this world to purchase us from that empty way of life that Billy Crystal described, to give us a purpose to be that positive influence, that healing influence in a world that is filled with sin, to give us purpose and meaning, to be a part of His work in this world that's full of pain and suffering. And friends, we can only do that when we see life through the lens of the cross and the empty tomb. Because it is there that we get to know this God who created the universe and us, and who wants to engage in this intimate, personal relationship with you. And it is through that relationship that we will ultimately find purpose and meaning in our individual lives. You know you were created for a higher purpose. I knew that. You've heard my story. I came to faith in Christ at the age of 23, in between graduating from college and going off to law school. And even before, I somehow sensed inside of me there had to be more to my life than what I was experiencing, you know, being a big shot on a fraternity on my college campus. Didn't know what it was, but there had to be more. And it wasn't until I came face to face with the cross and the empty tomb that I discovered it for my life. You will never find ultimate happiness until you begin to be motivated by that purpose, which you will only find at the cross and the empty tomb. It is there you will find a reason for living, and it is there that you will find, in response to the second line in that song, "Oh, but I'm afraid to die," you no longer need to fear dying. So that's principle number two. For one, purpose for living. Two, no fear of death. And it's a topic we have addressed recently as a church, as we have had a number of our Cedar Run family and their friends who have left this world. A number of you have just lost a parent even in the last week or two. But you know, this is a topic we need to talk about, not only at a memorial service, but on other times as well. Because I have concern that the fear of death for some of you could be robbing you of the joy of life. Where because of the cross and the empty tomb, we now have the opportunity to confidently speak these words written by the Apostle Paul to the church in Corinth. I'm going to have us read it together. 1 Corinthians 15:55. Say it. O death. Amen. You guys did so good. One more time. O death.
Death, where is your victory? O death, where is your
sting? We can say those words because Christ conquered death when he walked out of the tomb on that first Easter morning. It is why when we have a service here for someone who has left us, we call it a celebration service. Why? Because we're in denial? No, because we are celebrating that death in this world is simply that person's graduating, if you will, from life in this world with all its pain and confusion to the life God always intended for his children to experience. If Jesus was bodily raised from the dead, not only do we have meaning in life, but we no longer need to fear death. Why? Because Jesus both experienced and then conquered death. And because of that, we can now conquer death as well. Paul would write this to the church in Rome. And just to give my voice a break, I'm going to let you all say this one for me. For if we have been... seeing the resurrected Jesus on a number of occasions are not just fables, myths, right? Nice stories made up to give us reason to have positive things to talk about around our Easter meals. How can we be sure the tomb was really empty that first Easter morning? Well, to me, it's pretty simple. We can be sure because no one has ever been able to disprove it. Despite all of the motivations that existed to do just that. You know, it's so important that we understand, I think we lose sight of this sometimes, that Christianity is a religion based upon history. And because of that fact, it is put to one of the hardest tests of any faith claim. Because it is either true historically or it is not. Either Jesus was actually raised from the dead, or the Christian faith is a total delusion. Don't rely on me to take that point. The Apostle Paul, he said the same thing in 1 Corinthians 15:14 when he said this, "And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain." Understanding this fact that the whole message that Jesus came to proclaim could be defeated is why the chief priests were the ones who were the ones most complicit in having Jesus crucified were concerned about the body being taken. This is from the Matthew account, Matthew chapter 27, picking up in verse 62. It says, "The next day, that is, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, "Sir, we remember how that imposter," they're talking about Jesus, "said while he was still alive, 'After 3 days, I will rise.' Therefore, order the tomb to be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples go and steal him away and tell the people he has risen from the dead, and the last fraud will be worse than the first." They were aware of the danger in that. So what might have happened to the body? Because the historical accounts are consistent. No one was able to disprove that the tomb was empty. Because if they had been able to, I mean, the Christian faith would have died in its infancy, wouldn't it? And not only could no one disprove it then, neither has anyone been able to over the last 2,000 years, despite literally thousands trying to do so. There are whole sections in libraries of atheists who started out trying to disprove the resurrection, and in that effort ended up coming to faith in Jesus Christ. One was a man by the name of Lee Strobel. Lee was infuriated when his wife started going to church, all right? And then when she claimed she now had a personal relationship with Christ, he became apoplectic. So he went on a crusade. He was a journalist working for the Chicago newspaper. So he went on this crusade to intellectually disprove the resurrection account. Guess what? He ended up coming to faith in Christ and writing the incredible book, The Cause for Christ. There actually is a movie of the same name telling his story. Mrs. Morris and I just watched it together a couple weeks ago. Great movie. But let's take a moment, can we, to evaluate what might have happened to that body that was no longer in the tomb that first Easter morning. Over the years, there has only been one argument that has carried any real weight amongst those trying to disprove the resurrection account. It is referred to as the Passover plot. It says the disciples, when Jesus was taken down from the cross, recognizing that they were going to look foolish for how following this man who said he was going to rise from the dead, but was now deceased, they would go and steal the body, hide it, and could then claim what Jesus said about rising on the third day was true. The exact thing the chief scribes and the Pharisees were concerned about, right? Well, okay. Once you get past the fact that the tomb was protected by a very large stone and a group of Roman soldiers who were to guard its contents at the risk of losing their very lives if that body got stolen, once you get past that, you have to ask yourself, if the disciples were somehow able to overcome those challenges, you then come face to face with the fact that if it was a plot, a conspiracy, how do you explain that the 11 men behind that conspiracy, the disciples, were willing to all go to their deaths standing by the claim that he had in fact risen and that they had in fact seen the risen Jesus? All but one of those disciples was martyred in horrible fashion, crucified upside down. And yet they remained standing by the claim that Jesus had risen over the 40 years between that tomb being found empty and their own deaths. Not one ever wavered from claiming to have seen him, talked to him, put a finger at his side. And perhaps one of the best modern examples I have heard supporting the argument as to why the conspiracy argument carries no weight is one Chuck Colson tells. Chuck Colson, who was very high up in the Nixon administration, actually went to jail over the things that happened there, and in that, through that, he came to faith and started prison fellowship ministry, just a great ministry. Colson tells a story about the various men involved in the Watergate conspiracy. I know I'm getting old. How many here, any of our young people know what the Watergate conspiracy was? All right, anyway. For those of you that don't know, Watergate was the political scandal surrounding a burglary that took place at the Democratic National Committee offices in the Watergate building downtown. So that's the name. This scandal would ultimately bring down Richard Nixon's presidency. And where this relates to what we're talking here, and this comes from Colson's book, is how he'll tell in March of 1973, they were trying to cover this up, okay, this burglary. The cover-up began to unravel. And it took less than 1 month after John Dean, who was the president's counsel, began to tell the story of the cover-up to the special prosecutor, to the authorities. 1 month. And all the men around the president began to jump ship. They began to go get attorneys to bargain for immunity. So what's the point? It is that those men around the president were some of the most powerful men in this entire country. And they could not keep a lie going for 1 month. Yet we are to believe that those apostles who were weak and confused, Peter had already betrayed Jesus on 3 different occasions. Yet we're to believe that not one over the next 40 years would ever have started bargaining with the authorities to protect their very life by telling them where they had hid Jesus' body. And yet not one did. The only plausible answer is that they actually saw him after he was raised from the dead, and were ultimately filled with the power of his Holy Spirit. And that power was far greater than any human power. And that is why they were able to preach and proclaim with such boldness of this Jesus who not only conquered death, but who would allow them to conquer as well. And is why we, 2,000 plus years later, are still talking about it here together, right? In perhaps the most off-quoted of the Psalms, David would write these words. Psalm 23:4. I'm going to let you help me out again. Go ahead. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, David says, I will fear no evil. Why? Because he knew that God would be with him in that valley, and that God would take him through to that place he had prepared for him, where he would dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And friends, I mean, I don't want to insult your intelligence, but we're all going to face that valley one day, aren't we? But because of the cross and the empty tomb, we get to choose whether we will face it alone or whether we will put our trust in the truth that Jesus conquered death on our behalf, and so we can conquer it as well through trusting in Jesus' death to pay the penalty for our sins. And friends, when we come face to face with the cross and with the empty tomb, when we really grasp the lengths that God went to so we would not get left alone behind in that valley, it should enable us to no longer fear one day facing that valley, so long as Jesus is with you. So this Easter, if you never had before, give Jesus your fear by placing your faith in what Christ did for you when he died on that cross, and as he proved that his death was wholly adequate to pay your penalty, to pay my penalty, when he overcame death and grave that first Easter morning. Jesus himself said it this way, John 5:24. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word, believes him who sent me, has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but is passed from death to life. We need not fear death, because when we believe in, place a reliance on what Jesus did on the cross for us, we too will pass through the valley of the shadow of death to that life with the Lord that we were made for. But you have to say yes to Jesus. You see, my friends, and this is the essence of why Jesus had to die on that cross. A holy God created this world and everything in it, including you and me. Now, he gave us a free will, which will we use to rebel against God and to sin. Okay, all of us have. And a holy God was not about to allow our sin to get the final word. So he chose to send his only son, Jesus, to this earth, fully man and fully God, to give up his life on that cross, to pay the penalty that we could not pay, so that justice could be served through Jesus' death on the cross. And so we could then, through trusting in Jesus, be made righteous before God. You see, your only claim for admittance when you get to heaven, it's not good deeds you did or didn't do. It's not some religious act you did or didn't perform. It's not how much money you gave away. It is one thing and one thing only. It is your belief, your faith in the fact that Jesus died for your sins. That faith is the only thing that allows any of us to conquer death and to know we will spend eternity with the Creator God who loves us so. Jesus paid the price on the cross for my sins and for yours. Knowing that cost, anybody else in the universe would have cabled, "No! Exclamation point. Price too high." But friends, God looked at you through the eyes of his incredible love, and he cabled in the cross this message, written in his own blood: "No price too high. There is no price too high that I would not pay it in order to present you with the opportunity to again be in relationship with me." But again, you have to choose. It is not enough to just know it. When I was a youth, okay, high school, if you'd asked me, did I know this? Sure, I know it. I went to church every Sunday and said the creeds. I believe in one God, said it all. But I had never reached out to grab it. You must choose. God has done all he can do. People often say, well, why couldn't God have done something more? I mean, basically, we have a term. Have you ever used that term? Over my dead body? That's what God says to you and to me. Over my dead body. I did all that I can to give you this opportunity. But you have to receive what he did, to accept it for yourself. So I'm going to close this message. I don't do this a lot, but I'm going to do it today. I'm going to give anyone who might want to, whether you're listening online or you're here, an opportunity to do just that if you never have before, by simply telling God that you do believe in what he was doing for you through those two historical events of the cross and the empty tomb. I can do an altar call here. Not going to have any music playing. It's just you and your opportunity to tell God that you want to surrender your life to Jesus. So I'm going to ask everyone to just bow their heads. And if you want that and you've never had it before, then just pray with me these words, all right? Lord Jesus, I thank you for dying on that cross so that I could be forgiven of my sins, so that I can find purpose in my life, and so that I could conquer death and spend eternity with you in the life to come. I give to you this morning my life, Lord Jesus, as I ask you to be my Savior and to be my Lord. And I pray this in your name.
in the precious, precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, now, as the worship team comes forward to lead us in a closing song, we have a video that'll just close out, and then they'll play our closing worship song together.
This is a new day, a day of celebration, for God has given us a new birth, a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus. He's rescued us from the darkness. He's brought us out of despair. In Him we have redemption. In Him we have mercy. In Him we have forgiveness. Today we stand in Christ, a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. Today we celebrate our Savior, our Deliverer, our Redeemer. Sin is conquered. Death is defeated. The grave is empty, and Jesus is alive. This is a new day. This is Easter.
Amen. Let's all stand together.
Is in you. Thank you for spending. It's been such a blessing for us as a church to have all of you come and spend this Sunday with us. I've seen many of our college kids, I guess, that are home for their break. I've seen some old friends that I haven't seen in forever. So it's just good to have you all with us. If you're here visiting, hopefully we'll get to chat with you before you leave. I know it's Easter, so you got to get there for those hams and other things that are cooking. But if you can hang around a while, I'll be here. Pastor Blake will be here. We'd love to get to say hi to you. So pray with me now as we close out this time. Oh, our hope is in you, Jesus Messiah. What a blessed hope it is. It is the hope that does not disappoint. It is the hope that even when we grieve, when someone leaves this world that we love so, we do not grieve as those who have no hope. Because we know that through you, Lord, death is just then step into that next time we go to be with you in heaven for all eternity. So, Lord, I pray for this Easter. I pray for all the families, the get-togethers. I pray, Lord, for those that maybe are hurting right now, that are struggling. Lord, just may your peace and presence just be with them in such a tangible way that they know it's you, Lord Jesus, saying, don't worry, it's okay. I got you. I got you. We pray it all in the precious name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. And everybody said, amen. Amen. God bless you. Happy Easter. Amen.